Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Med by David Poyer. Narrated by David Stifel. Every discussion of duty has two parts. One part deals with the question of the supreme good. The other, with the rules that should guide our ordinary lives. Cicero, on moral duties. Part 1. Line of Departure. Chapter 1. The Central Mediterranean. 40 miles from land, the sea heaves in pre-dawn darkness. No buoy, no man-made mark interrupts the undulant glitter of stars on an easterly swell. The destroyer is a sharp-edged shadow against Cassiopeia. Since midnight, she has cruised slowly before the prevailing sea. But at 0400, suddenly, she heels as her rudders bite water. The hum of turbines rises to a whine, the sound rolling out into blackness, and a phosphorescent waterfall shoots from the screws. As she gathers speed, she begins to pitch, dipping her bow to the swell, then lifting to shake hissing spray into the sea. Above her wake, a stain of smoke unrolls against the sky. The line of departure for an amphibious assault is drawn not through dark waves over the mirror of stars, but across a Navy chart in number 2 lead. On one side, in the minds of men, is peace, and on the other, the irrevocable commitment to battle. The destroyer crosses the line, still accelerating, sonar pinging into the deep, radar sweeping the sky. Its gray sides fade to black. A single dimmed stern light retreats into the night. The waves of its passing widen and then disappear, merging at last with the unchanging sea. Half an hour later, 6 gray ships slowly lift into view to the east. At first, only their masts show above an empty horizon, against the faint glow that precedes morning. Then they grow closer, not speedily, but with a steady and inexorable pace. They are not so sleek, nor so fast, nor so heavily armed as the destroyer that escorted them 10 miles in advance, but they are larger, swelling with displacement curves rather than the fine lines of speed. Instead of guns and missile launchers, their decks are cluttered with helicopter pads and replenishment stations, stacks of containers, and nested landing craft. In the faint light rises deck on deck of superstructure, topped by the vertical spikes of booms and funnels. Flung wide across miles of sea, the task force moves across its face with ponderous eagerness. And from each ship, above the antennas and signal lines, streams the red and white striped ensign of impending battle. The landing has begun. USS Guam, LPH 9. High in the island of the helicopter carrier, a stocky man in khakis thrusted his face angrily into binoculars. He raised them with the ship's roll, leaning into the combing, examining a shadow that steamed parallel to her, 4,000 yards away. The glasses remained level for several minutes. Then Captain Isaac I. Sundstrom, Commander, Mediterranean Amphibious Ready Group, jerked them down. He muttered into the fresh wind of a 20-knot passage and turned for the interior of the flag bridge. "Commodore's on the bridge!" At the shout, officers and enlisted men looked up from dimly lit charts, flickering radars. They glanced at one another, but only one man, a lieutenant, junior grade, moved cautiously toward Sundstrom, his hand rising automatically to his helmet, saluting unseen in the darkness. "Good morning, Commodore." "Dan, morning." The words were short with anger and fatigue. "What's going on? Are we ready to hit the beach?" The lieutenant's name was Dan Lenson. Seen by the faint radiance of a vertical plot, He was taller than the Commodore, and almost unnaturally thin, hair somewhere between sandy and dark. He too looked tired. Rubbing a sun-bleached mustache with the back of his hand, he pitched his voice above the roar of wind, the hiss of radios. "Commodore, we're on 280 true, speed 19. The amphibs are in circular formation for movement to assault. Guam's the guide in station zero. Barnstable County is dead ahead. Newport on the starboard beam. Spiegel Grove starboard quarter. Charleston port quarter." Coronado lagged back during the night. I shifted Charleston to her station at 0200. "Screen units, alt is 20,000 yards ahead of the main body, sanitizing our track into the beach. The other destroyers are deployed along the air threat axis." His eyes shifted to a board behind the Commodore. "Equipment status. Both of Coronado's boilers are online now, and she's catching up. 8 miles astern last time I looked. Alt has an anchor casualty that's being worked on right now. Barnstable reported radar trouble again." "She'll need that during beach approach." "Damn it," said the Commodore, looking out at the darkness.
"Yes, sir."
The lieutenant waited, then went on when his senior did not continue. "Other than that, all units of Task Force 6-1 and embarked Marines report ready for the assault. We're at H-100 now. Where are we on track? Are we up with intended movement?"
"I hold us dead on so far, sir."
"I think we're falling behind. Let's play it safe. God damn it, I don't want to be late again."
"That will make it harder for Coronado to catch up, sir. If she isn't in position for that first wave..."
"You heard me, Dan. I don't like to give orders twice." The lieutenant studied him. Dawn was coming. He could make out the sagging, lined face under graying hair.
"Aye, aye, sir," he said at last. "I'll signal another knot speed increase. Mr. Flasher."
"Got it,"
said a voice from the darkness.
"Dan, you've got to keep me informed. I'm not getting the proper reports."
"Sir, the chief staff officer was up here most of the midwatch. I thought he was..."
"Don't count on that zero, Dan. He's disappointed me too often."
"Yes, sir."
"We're ready to go then, as far as I can see. Have you talked to the Guam's bridge yet this morning?"
"Just a few words, Commodore."
"Would you like me to..."
"Forget it," said the older man. His face settled, his head lowering itself toward his chest. His eyebrows drew together.
"I told you last night to keep close tabs on that brown shoe son of a bitch. Remember how Forchetti screwed things up in Bizerte when that helo went into the drink? That's not how I want things run. When my captains look bad, I look bad. And I don't like to look bad. That's the name of the game, Dan."
"Yes, sir."
"I'll do it. Just like I have to do most of what gets done around here."
"Yes, sir," Lenson said again, to the Commodore's back. As the door to the bridge wing opened, a blast of sound hit them. 50 feet below, on the flight deck, 10 helicopters were beginning their flight checks. The roar of their engines warming up made Lenson cover his ears. Several of the near aircraft had engaged transmissions, and their blades began to whip around, slowly at first, but then faster, until in the dim deck-edge lights they blurred into misty disks. The smells of exhaust and kerosene and hot metal mingled with the wind that blew back along the deck from the sea. The Commodore seemed not to notice it. Below him, around him, something massive was taking form out of the night. Leaning over the combing, he swept his gaze along the length of his flagship. From her blunt, rounded bow, where the flight deck stopped abruptly, aft along a flat sweep of deck to the forest of antennas and nets at the stern, the carrier teemed with men and machines. Men ran in the growing light among the vibrating fuselages. Flight deck personnel in comm helmets and colored jerseys bent to check chocks and unplug starter cables.
Armorers rolled bomb dollies toward four streamlined attack helos that now were adding their scream to the symphonic din that pounded along the deck, spilling out over the sea. Marines and drab utilities clambered in and out of cockpits. Another helicopter came into view, rising from the red-lit hangar below. The elevator locked, and a tractor swung in, towing it toward its launch station. Hatches slammed open, and from deep in the ship, more men streamed out onto the flight deck. Helmets pulled low, packs jogging on their backs, and rifles held nursing close to their chests. The Marines bent low beneath the revolving swords of the rotors. Sundstrom raised his glasses, and after a moment, so did Lenson. Ahead of them, beyond 4,000 yards of rushing sea, was the same frenzy of activity. Barnstable County was a tank landing ship, an LST. She was smaller than the Guam, but at seven magnifications, her decks too were busy with sailors in faded dungarees. Aft of her, on the horizon to their right, was another ship, too far and small to see movement, though it was there, and two more gray specks far back, destroyers and frigates, escorting and protecting the larger ships that now moved and readied themselves here in the center, the heart of a vast formation that had flung its moving nets of steel and data, radio waves and sound, over 3,000 square miles of the central Mediterranean. Lenson, looking at the Commodore, saw his lips move. He leaned toward him, careful not to brush his arm. Sundstrom disliked being touched.
"Sir?"
he shouted into the mounting roar of engines.
"Sloppy."
"Sir, do you want me to—" But he had already turned away, disappearing up a ladder leading to the bridge deck. Guam's captain held sway there. Lenson straightened and half smiled. He went back into the flag bridge, pausing to dog the weather hatch against the steady beat of engines.
"Dan?"
It was a chubby lieutenant with overlong hair. His helmet strap was unbuckled, and he had shoved it back. Where'd he go now?
"I read. Up to see Forchetti, I guess."
"What for?"
"Probably wants him to go to general quarters. He does it earlier every landing."
"I think—"
The ship's announcing system blared out just then, jerking their heads around.
"Flight quarters, flight quarters. All hands, man your battle stations. Set material condition zebra throughout the ship."
A gong began to sound, strident, insistent. From below them came the thud of running feet. The red-haired lieutenant, buckling on a life jacket, shouted,
"Want me to take it for you? You haven't had breakfast, have you?"
"No, been up here since 0100. I ought to check on SAC, too."
"Thanks, Red." "I hear you. Now get out of here."
"I stand relieved."
Three decks down, deep in the steel labyrinth of the ship, Lenson groped through a litter of maps and overlays, messages and green-bound Marine Corps artillery pubs for the cup he had left wedged there at midnight. The coffee was cold, but thick with sugar. As he sipped at it, he slumped backward in his chair.
"Tired, Lieutenant?"
He bobbed upright, seeing a second-class petty officer old enough to be his father, with a seamed face and graying hair to match. He smiled.
"A little. Between here and the flag bridge, I forget what my rack looks like. You getting the circuits up, Mac?"
"Sure, Mr. Lenson. What's the skinny?"
Turning, they both looked straight ahead, to where one end of the compartment was covered with a huge map. Fully 9 feet by 9, it writhed in 5 colors over the bulkhead. Sea blue, shading toward green near the shore, yellow of beach, of sandy plains, the crowded green terrain of foothills, black V's of washed-out gullies, red lines of roads. Glossy plastic protected the dozens of symbols and numbers that had been drawn over its surface in the last 48 hours.
"We've still got over an hour to H," said Lenson. His voice was a murmur over the ceaseless hissing from the speakers. The petty officer had to lean forward to hear him. "Anyway,
When the rest of the team gets here, get your comm checks started. You should have the gunships, Alt, Bowen, the two Turks, and the Italian can, coming up on the gunnery coordination net. The Turks may take a couple of calls to answer. They weren't very cooperative at the pre-sale conference. So, he glanced at his watch and got up. You've got her, Mac. Be back as soon as I can. Lenson paused in the passageway to dog the door, then broke into a run. He turned at a stenciled arrow and slid down a metal ladder. 100 feet on, the corridor narrowed and filled with breakfast smells. By a door marked Officer's Country, a row of khaki and green caps stirred like impatient guests as the carrier rolled. In the wardroom, he pulled out a chair between two other men, both of whom were eating as fast as they could. "Anything good, Stan?" he asked the one to his left. "It's all good," muttered the supply officer. "It all tastes the same, too. Lay off, Dan. It gets old after 3 months out here."
"Hey," said the man on his right, a Marine major. "You just come down from the bridge?"
"Flag bridge, not ship's bridge. Why?"
"What's going on? How far out are we?"
Lenson reached eagerly for the cup the steward rattled down at his elbow.
"Another hour to H. We're 20 miles from the coast yet."
"Shit," said the Marine.
"Eager?"
"Driving those Cobras is better than sex.
And they pay you. What do you do aboard?"
"I'm with the staff," said Lenson, not enthusiastically.
"You know, your supporting fire, ships, guns, aircraft, artillery."
"Sure."
"I coordinate that.
We keep the opposition's heads down as you go in, take out positions that threaten the ship-to-shore movement, then cover the Marines as they head inland."
"Staff, huh? You work for Ike Sundstrom?"
"That's right. I hear he's kind of hard to get along with."
The lieutenant stared at his coffee. "He's the man in charge," he said at last, his voice hard. "He wouldn't have 4 stripes if he didn't know what he was doing." The Marine stared at him for a moment and seemed about to speak. Then his look dropped to Lenson's heavy academy ring, then continued on up the left bicep where it emerged from the short sleeve, showing the puckered flesh of an old third-degree burn. He nodded, looked away, and said nothing more. A plate appeared in front of the thin JG. He began to eat rapidly, greasing the food down with coffee. 7 minutes later, he was in his stateroom. Throwing himself on the lower of 2 bunks, he covered his eyes with an arm for a moment, and then removed it. Under the upper bunk, wedged into the webbing, a photograph lay fixed 6 inches above his open eyes. The woman was dark-haired, and she was in bed. Her arms were crossed under her head, and the wary alertness of her eyes contrasted strangely with her teasing smile, with the way her bare nipples poked directly out toward the camera. A few minutes went by, and he lay motionless. Once he checked his watch. The ventilators breathed air into the tiny room. His shirt and trousers were soaked with old sweat. "I need a shower," he thought. "No, I need sleep." But he knew there would be no sleep. Not that day. Any minute now, he thought, lying rigidly in his bunk. Any minute.
"Lieutenant Lenson, lay to the flag bridge," said the ship's announcing system suddenly. It hissed for a moment, and then went on. "Attention, all hands. H hour has been delayed 1/2 hour by the Commander Amphibious Task Force. I say again, H hour has been delayed 1/2 hour by the CATF. Make all preparations for H hour at 06:30.
The depression in the bunk that had taken Lenson's weight was already gone. He was halfway back to the radios, the charts, and the short, angry man who paced impatiently high above the sea. USS Alt, DD 698.
10 miles ahead of the flagship, a huge-bellied man in khaki trousers and grease-smeared t-shirt thrust himself through a hatchway and into a tiny compartment. Elbowing away a knot of equally dirty sailors, he aimed his face upward toward a mass of gears, shafts, and cables that came through the overhead and continued down through the deck.
"Where's the flashlight, Sternegel? You think I'm a friggin' owl?"
One of the sailors hastened to thrust a light at him. The big man flicked it to one side to examine a handwheel and brake assembly, then forward into the very bow to the chain tube. The anchor chain itself filled the locker beneath their feet, fathoms of rusty, tumbled links, each 5 inches across and 20 pounds in weight. Then he aimed it upward, to the massive mechanism that fed it onto the forecastle, to the ground tackle. He stared for a long moment, then turned so quickly that the 3 other men in the closet-sized space flattened themselves against rusty steel.
"Pollock!" he bawled aft, through the hatch. "Mason! Lay back to the gear locker. Biggest pry bar you can find. 2 lifting hooks, 6 inches, and 100 feet of 21 thread. Smee!"
"Yeah, Chief."
"Operator's station up on the forecastle. Tell whoever's on it to cut power to the windlass. Don't ease out, don't haul in, just stand easy. Move!"
Men turned instantly, pelting aft and upward, boots echoing from steel amid machinery crowded so close they had to turn sideways even as they ran.
"Stewie, haul ass up to the bridge. Find that new ensign, or Mr. J, or the XO if you see them first. Tell them Chief Ronowitz has a jammed shift mechanism on the... No, better keep it simple. Just say, a casualty on the anchor windlass."
When the first class two was gone, the large man sighed. He reached up to touch the gritty, half-greased surface of a cam, and his teeth showed under a half-growth of dark beard. Behind him, unseen by him, the 2 sailors who were left exchanged apprehensive looks.
"Blaney," he muttered.
"Chief?"
"I want Blaney. Get that slack-wristed scumcock down here on the double."
His roar echoed around the compartment, and the men crouched as if a steam line was about to break. He had his mouth open again when a sudden humming came from the windlass motor beside him, and he jerked his hand free and danced back with the lightness of a squirrel.
"Watch it, Chief."
"I'll have him shut down, Chief," said one of the men, and he too disappeared.
Ronowitz, rubbing one of his massive, greasy hands with the other, glowered at the jammed mechanism, then glanced up and around him. The Alt's wartime designer had built her forepeak for thin midgets. Gear lockers and paint lockers and ground tackle had been crammed into the sharp stem of the old destroyer. The bulkheads and overhead were lined with cable runs and piping. The deck was slippery with oil. This far forward, the engine's whining roar was deadened to a rumble, but the vibration of the seas as the bow shattered them a few feet ahead made the confined air tremble around the waiting men. The stinks of grease, rust, paint thinner, and the powerful smell of Ronowitz himself mingled in a miasma of confusion and disaster. The humming died. The sailors dispatched aft came running back, swearing as they tripped over knee knockers, hanks of heaving line, cans of red lead. Immediately the chief set them to work. As one hastily connected a sound-powered telephone, 2 others braced themselves around the windlass mechanism and began to maneuver the pry, a tapered 9-foot iron bar into place with its sharp end under the jammed assembly. Ronowitz, meanwhile, had been looking around. He found a wooden block and wedged it tightly under the bar, against the winch housing. As he stepped back, he bumped into someone behind him and barked,
"Jesus! Get your ass out of here! Ronowitz don't need a goddamn audience of thousands when he's working."
"Chief?"
The voice was hesitant. His head still turned away from it, the big man's face altered. Then he turned, moving an inch or so to give the other room.
"Ensign Callan," he said,
his voice flat.
"One of the men said you were having some trouble down here," said the officer. He was husky, too, though nowhere near the size of the chief. He was clean-shaven, with a truculent look, though his voice had none of the confidence of his build and expression. No more than 21, he wore a set of gleaming, oversized gold bars, and his new khakis were creased and clean.
"What's the, problem?"
"Brace yourselves against the roll," said the chief, looking at the waiting men, two of them hanging on the lever end of the pry, the others standing ready with wrenches. One, looking scared, was holding a hammer he had taken out of his belt. "Got a jammed anchor winch, sir," he said to Callan. "This motor here turns the wildcat through these gears. This hand wheel shifts between the wildcat and the capstan. The lower part of it here engages up into these notches. There's a lot of slop in them now, and this pawl here, see, didn't engage right. Plus, I think that handbrake assembly's hosed, too. The way the wildcat..."
"The capstan, you mean?"
"No, sir. Line goes on the capstan. Chain goes on the wildcat. Anyway, it's jammed tight as an Irishman in a Hong Kong whore. Stoy, is she dead now? Break her open?"
"Main deck says yes, chief. They didn't understand before. They were trying to rock it out."
"Rock it out? I'll rock that asshole. See if they have the stopper on."
"Says it's on."
"Fucking well better be. All right, let's put some Swedish steam on that bar."
"Chief," said the ensign quietly, "what are you doing up here? Isn't this First Division's space?"
"Those fucking deck apes can't find their butts in the dark with both hands, sir. If somebody don't get this jam cleared, we can kiss off standing in close this morning." He motioned to the bar. "Okay, girls, hop to it."
Two men heaved at the pry. It moved slightly under their weight, then stopped. The pawl moved a bit, then slid back between the notches.
"Ask them topside if they got the brake on."
"Yes, they do, chief," said the man with the phones.
"We need some slack. Who's on the control?"
"That new guy, what's his name, the black kid?"
"Take him off. Get the petty officer on the switch. Tell him I want her backed off about 3 inches. Just that much. You two, get away from that pry."
"Chief," said the ensign again, "how long?"
"Look, ensign, I can't tell you how long it's going to take to fix until I fix it. This always happens when the gut MBMs gun deck their maintenance. Sometimes it takes a couple minutes, once it took a day. I had to unbolt the axle frame and take it all apart. You better get out of the way, sir. There's likely to be a lot of grease and shit flying around in here."
Callan's face closed even more. He set his lips, then moved back.
"Go on then, chief.
If it doesn't work in a couple of minutes..."
"Yeah, good, sir."
The motor hummed again, and the chain rattled and scraped in the hawse pipe. The humming stopped.
"The other way," said Ronowitz, watching it. "A cunt here will do it."
The motor reversed itself. The gears made a grinding noise, making them all start, and then reversed too.
"Hands to it, now," said the chief,
drawing a massive forearm across his mouth. Black grease smeared his beard.
"Heave!"
Again the men set themselves against the rolling ship. Again the bar gave for the first inch or two, and then set solid, wedged tight, giving not at all. The sailors strained, their necks rigid, muscles bunched, sweat starting on their faces. Nothing moved.
"Chief," said the man at the sound-powered phones,
"they got a problem with the steering engine aft. Can't tell if it's controls or what."
"Call an electrician. Tell them."
"Say they did. He don't know what's wrong with it, he says."
"Jesus H. Christ," bawled Ronowitz to the universe.
He stared at the sailors. They had slacked off, unable to put their full strengths to the bar for long, but afraid to take their hands from it so long as he was watching. His massive shoulders slumped, but it was a slump of exasperation, not of defeat. Not yet.
Get off that bar, he said to them.
Chief, don't you think a block and tackle get some multiplication of force on it?
Yes, sir, Mr. Callan. Multiplication of force. Lots of room down here for that. Just let me make love to her once first.
The sailors moved apart silently, and Ronowitz put his shoulder to the bar. He tested it, waggling the end to be sure the pointed shaft was deep inside the mechanism, just where it refused its greasy union, and braced his grease-speckled boots. The bar suddenly sank into the fleshy part of his arm, just above an old tattoo. Ronowitz grunted deep in his chest and shifted his legs to one side, so that he leaned forward into the ship, the bar coming out of his shoulder and into the guts of the winch. Slowly, he began to straighten. The bar bent, arched, the iron set as stubbornly as the massive back that bent into it, that humped in swelling muscle under the filthy t-shirt, dark with sudden sweat between the wide shoulder blades.
Chief!
He grunted again, mindlessly. His eyes, turned from the others, were squeezed closed. His lips drew back, showing dental gold and decaying teeth, and his breath hissed out between them. Callan bent through the hatchway, his face dark.
Chief, leave it, he muttered. Let the bosun's mates do it. Go back to the engine room. We need you there.
Can do it.
Get aft.
The sailors exchanged looks. That had been an order. But not a muscle of the chief's body changed, only to lean harder, harder into the rigid metal, as if will alone could force matter to yield.
Coming,
he grunted. With a grating sound, the bar stirred. The chief relaxed slightly, took a new hold, then levered his whole weight upward and then down on the quivering hilt. The bar bent slowly, and the mechanism rasped and moved slightly, and then suddenly gave a bang, like a pistol going off. The ensign jumped. Ronowitz stepped back, sweating mightily, and the iron fell with a clang.
Hand me that light, he panted. Yeah, there, it's in. Sternagel, finish her up. Grease this fucker good. That's probably what caused the jam. And get all this crap out of the locker before you secure, or it'll lop some poor fucker's head off next time we drop.
He turned, and his eyes met Callan's for a long moment.
You say there's more trouble back aft, sir?
When they had left, the big man a pace behind the one in khaki, one of the sailors went down on a knee to pick up the iron. An inch and a half thick. It had bent near the end of the shaft through an angle of 30 degrees. The men looked after the two figures.
God damn, whispered one of them. Pretty good, said one of the others.
Then added in a low voice that nevertheless carried clearly to every man who stood there, his hands dangling by his side.
For a old man.
USS Spiegel Grove. LSD-12. 2,000 yards astern of the Guam, deep in the belly of a squat old ship, a private first class named Givens sat nodding in the midst of a score of other Marines, hunched like fetuses in the dim red light, jammed together like subway passengers at rush hour. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. The operating handle of a machine gun dug into his left side, the curve of a mortar base plate into his right. The shelf he sat on was steel, the low overhead also of metal, crisscrossed with insulation and swaying with life jackets, pressed down to the crown of his lowered helmet. Strapped to him, wired to him, part of him, he wore the issue pack, haversack, blanket roll, two canteens that sloshed with the roll of the ship, a pistol belt and sidearm, first aid kit, gas mask, and poncho. Two canisters protruded above his pack,
and he carried a third under his arm. They held mortar shells. His polished black boots were planted solid and motionless on the gritty floor of the Amtrak. His face was expressionless, except for tension at the corners of thin, tightly closed lips. His bony, scarred hands rested on the oiled barrel of the 81-millimeter mortar that he carried clamped between his legs. Will Givens, age 18, swayed motionless, his eyes closed. On one side of him, a corporal named Cutford snuffled in his sleep. On the other, Sergeant Silkworth, the mortar team squad leader, whispered mad obscenities to himself, polishing his battalion famous profanities. The closed interior of the amphibious tank stank of diesel oil and old vomit. The 20 Marines had been sealed there without movement for 2 hours now. Nodding there, half asleep himself, Givens dreamed his way back into the morning. 4th Platoon had had reveille passed on them at 4 that morning by the gunny. Will had rolled out faster than usual, knowing this was the day. He'd been pulling on his second pair of socks when Corporal Cutford leaned out of the blinking light of the overhead, his face blank and lightless as the inside of a mortar tube, and said,
"Fuckhead, you."
"What you want, Corporal?"
"You, Oreo. Shit detail."
"I had it yesterday, Cutford, and the day before."
"And you got it again, Oreo. DD into that head, you hear me? All ass, fuckhead. We hitting a beach today. No time waiting breakfast for shit-eating prives."
He finished dressing, enough for the detail at least. His worn soft trousers bloused into unlaced boots, skivvy shirt from the day before. In the head, he bent to draw water into a scrub bucket amid the Niagara roar of urinating Marines, then pulled swab and disinfectant from the cleaning locker. The solution rushed over the terrazzo, chasing into rusty dark corners under the thrones, islanding the men as they squatted. He swabbed away grimly, ignoring curses and threats. Today no one lingered. The head emptied as quickly as it had filled. Givens lifted the swab, swirled it to separate the gray strands, slapped it down to the deck, drew it along in swift parallel lines, taking up the gray water. Under it, the terrazzo came clean, white base and green and red and blue flecks of color showing sharp and clear in the sour ammonia tang.
"Will, I'll finish up."
Givens looked up. The Marine lingered uncertainly in the hatchway, his face white as porcelain. Pimples showed where his uniform collar rubbed, and though he was no older than Givens, his skivvy shirt showed a line of blonde fuzzed gut above his belt.
"Cutford told me to do it."
"He did?
No, I'm on the list for today. He's just on your case again, man."
"Yeah.
All right, washout. Thanks."
He straightened, passed over the swab, and went out to the bunk room to pick up his blouse. The chow line was short. Two cooks in ketchup-stained Spiegel's Eagles t-shirts were ladling out the last scraps of sausage and dry toast. Givens got the last egg and slid into a seat with some infantrymen. They glanced at him without welcome, but kept eating. The upcoming operation was making everyone silent, and they were all tired. The heavy seas of the past few days took a lot of energy from men cooped below decks, stewed in the same sweaty air, heat, damp, and boredom. He came back from memory to reality, to now, at a sudden snarl from the Amtrak's engine. The Marine stirred as the starter whined again, and then the diesel, not 10 feet from any of them, burst into clattering life. A dim blue light came on over Cutford's head, like an infernal halo, and the corporal leaned forward. Sweat glistened on his skin, and against the hair at his open blouse, Will Givens caught a twisted gleam of gold. He leaned too, tensing, to look forward to where the A-driver crouched in his turret. The gears meshed with a bang, and the track began to roll.
its treads clawed at the steel deck, jolting over tie-downs, sending every slam and lurch straight up to their backbones. Givens wedged himself into the seat, tightening his hands on the mortar. Low and heavy, the amphibious tanks floated with only a couple of feet of freeboard. Sometimes he remembered when they hit the water, they didn't float at all. The men locked inside didn't have much of a chance then. Any minute now. 25 tons of steel and men launched itself into the sea. He felt a moment of falling, then heard the clatter of the diesel change timbre, became a heavier mutter. The exhaust burbled like a drowning giant behind them. Received, then yielded up again reluctantly by the sea, they leaned with a slow, waterlogged roll. Givens stared across the aisle at Washman, Washout, and the white boy stared back at him, his face sober. They looked at each other for several seconds, and then Washman managed a scared wink. Givens smiled slowly and then winked back. The Amtrak began to turn. The big tracks, efficient and fast for something of their weight on land, were underpowered and logy in the water. He felt his body grow light and then crash down. They were in open sea, on their way to the beach. A single ray of sun came shooting back from the A-driver's viewport. With the 20 other captives, he stared at it as it danced along, briefly gilding the pronged barrel of the machine gun, swaying to Silky's bulging crotch, Harner's vacant grin, the tops of Cutford's white socks. Given's long fingers splayed over the spiral threads of the tube, and then fled out of their dark compartment as the track turned once again. He steadied the mortar with his knees and reached up to wipe his forehead. His hand came away dripping, and he used his sleeve next. His mouth began to water. He slipped off his helmet and pulled from the liner the candy sack he had saved against this ride. At the sound of his retching, the other Marines groaned. The life jackets danced in close gloom as the track corkscrewed. The seas grew steeper as they closed the beach, bottlenecked by the rising bottom, and the track soared and plunged and rolled. The air stank of diesel fumes. Givens had started it, but most of the troops were sick now, using utility caps, paper bags, shirt pockets, anything to keep it off the deck of the Amtrak. They had swabbed it up too many times before. Only Silkworth and Cutford leaned back against the vibrating steel, the squad leader watching with a smile of disdain, the lance corporal with an expression that could be either contempt or hatred. USS Guam. 8 miles to seaward of them, high on the bridge of the flagship, Isaac Sundstrom dropped his binoculars to dangle against the rows of ribbons on his tropical khaki.
Lenson, get me Haynes.
Sir?
Colonel Haynes, where is he?
I think he's in helo direction, sir.
Or he might be...
Find him.
Ask him if it's convenient for him to come up to Flagbridge.
Colonel Stephen Haynes, USMC, was in charge of the 2,000-plus Marines in Mao 3-2. His troops were embarked in all 6 amphibs and directed from Haynes' command center on the Guam. When he came up, Sundstrom was staring landward again, his binoculars on the leading wave. The coast was a line of brown, the surf a strand of white caught between blue sea and a climbing slope of foothills. Between the flagship, 16,000 yards out, and that seemingly motionless line, 9 ships stood closer in. 2 of them were the LSTs, Newport and Barnstable County. The 3rd and 4th were Spiegel Grove and Coronado. The LSD and LPD carried both Amtraks and assault boats. They were underway, steaming parallel to the beach, while black specks tumbled from their sterns in plumes of spray, the second assault wave. Beyond them, low and black against the land,
The destroyers rowed close inshore. Alt, Bowen, the Italians and Turks. Their guns pointed toward the empty hills. And beyond them, closest in of all, a line of dark dots yawed and threw foam, streaming blue smoke as they wallowed almost imperceptibly toward the surf. The two men watched tensely, silently. A rumble grew above them, and suddenly two jets flashed overhead, canted lazily away from the beach, and slanted down above a headland to the east. Metal glimmered beneath them, tumbling, then dirty smoke leaped up. Moments later came the brump of a stick of bombs.
"How do they look, Steve?" said the Commodore at last, not turning.
"Not too bad. Scattered, but that could be the seas. Surf heights 4 at last report.
It's pretty rough for the Mike 6s.
"You think so?"
"I think they're dropping the goddamn ball on us. The boat group commander's 400 yards left of where he should be. That's why none of them are on track."
"They look pretty close on the screen," said the colonel.
"You're a perfectionist, Ike. That's what they told me about you before we met."
"Somebody has to be," said the Commodore.
But Haynes' words might have pleased him. At least he smiled.
"Other than that, how are we?"
"Some problems. Nothing we can't iron out. We've been at this for a while."
"You'd think after 3 months in the med, but some people just can't get it straight. Like this chief staff officer of mine, Hogan. Like my intel team."
"Nothing personal, Steve, but a few of your men, too.
And the ship's commanding officers don't have the big picture, either. Their noses are down in their own little rice bowls. They don't understand somebody has to quarterback the whole pie, make sure the operation doesn't fall through the cracks. And frankly, anyone who doesn't realize that, well, he isn't worthy to be wearing khaki."
The Commodore leaned back against the combing.
"Fine day, though, isn't it?"
"Except for the surf," said the colonel.
He stared to landward.
"Some of those bulldozers, when they come off the causeways, this beach is notorious for soft patches in the sand."
"You've warned them about it? Ordered them to wear life jackets?"
"Of course, Ike," said Haynes quietly. "I've seen drowned men before."
"Is everything else on schedule? When they hit, how soon can you be ready to pull out again?"
"I'll be ready any time, but I'd hope to get a couple of days ashore. The men get antsy cooped up. 48 hours.
I want them to prepare for a quick withdrawal, as soon as objective is reached."
"Understood," said the colonel, losing the agreeable look he had worn since he arrived on the bridge. For a moment, he and the Commodore stared at opposite ends of the beach.
Below them at that moment, two decks down, Lieutenant Lenson was repeating himself for the fourth time, shouting over the whine and static of unsynchronized transmitters at a Turkish destroyer. And inshore of them, deep within one of the warlike silhouettes that rode gray against white of surf and brown of hills, Chief Ranowitz, squinting against fluorescent light, grunted a warning about voltage regulation to the nervous watchstander in front of number one switchboard in the forward engine room. 4 miles inland, the skids of the first helicopter slammed into the dirt at the landing zone. And Private First Class Will Givens and 19 other seasick Marines felt the scrape of beach under the treads. They seized their weapons as the nose lifted. The engine roared anew, shifting gears to maneuver inland, and then 2 dozen tons of Amtrak skidded sideways as the driver braked. The hatch banged down into a blinding wall of daylight, and they pounded down the ramp, yelling as they dropped to their bellies onto sand and scrub, jacking cartridges into their rifles. A long blast of fire ripped out ahead of them. Given saw the muzzle flashes between the dunes. Burdened with the mortar, he drew his pistol clumsily.
"Machine gun!" screamed Cutford beside him.
The dark face was distorted.
"Ready! Advance!
Hoorah!"
They charged forward. He fled over scrub brush, air hot in his throat, the sand turning his run into a nightmare stumble. Ahead of him, the hidden gun chattered steadily. He fired wildly, not aiming, just making noise, and at that moment, something caught his foot and he fell. Fell hard, knocking the wind out of him with agonizing force. He lay there for a long moment, watching the sand and trying to breathe. So many grains, alike from a distance, but up close each unique and only itself. A man walked toward him across the dunes. His eyes found Givens, steadied on him. Givens stiffened. He started to get up. The man walked up to him. "You're dead," he said. Givens sagged back into the sand. The umpire strolled on. A Marine ran by him, shouting. The umpire caught his arm. The man crumpled. He grabbed at his leg and began shouting for a corpsman. Cutford returned, cursing him. Pulling the mortar from his unresisting arms, the corporal ran on under a double load, not looking back. And the whole immense mechanism of Task Force 6-1, over 2,000 Marines, 3,000 sailors, 11 ships, 40 aircraft, continued the strike inland toward a dot on a map, toward an imaginary enemy somewhere in the silent sweep of sere and empty hills. For it was all an exercise. It was all a game. Every man knew that, just another in an unending series of practices in a navy that, it sometimes seemed to them, had been built and manned and maintained for 40 years of peace, 5,000 miles from home, just for drill. It had been the same through 3 months of the 6 months deployment. This was just another exercise. It would go well or badly. Some men would make mistakes and be reprimanded. Others would do well and be complimented. But then it would be finished, and then there would be liberty. And then it would be over and could be forgotten. Because it was a drill, and none of it was for real. This time. The Baqa'a Valley, Lebanon. The air over the camp blazed with light. It boiled with windless heat above flat asphalt, off the tin roofs of the wooden barracks. Built by the British, one of the men from the committee had told him. The tall man thought it a sign. The dark humor of a god beyond history, but determining it all, who fought for those who fought for him. The desert air boiled above the obstacle course, the barbed wire gate, the dusty road that stretched off toward the firing range. Ana Abu Harissa crouched in full sunlight, blinking sweat from his eyes. In his pocket, his thumb found the stopwatch.
"Begin."
The assault pistol leapt of itself into his hands. Short-barreled, with a collapsible stock, it had a moment before been invisible beneath his civilian jacket. In the same motion, he was at full sprint across the tarmac, running. Ahead, the glint and shimmer of aluminum. Behind, the thud of many pairs of boots. When the flat pop of automatic weapons began, he flinched but kept on. His back felt naked. He ran as if to outdistance bullets. His own weapon jerked in his hands, and spent cartridges leapt up to brand his forehead, glittering like broken-off bits of desert sun. They were past practicing with blanks. A man shape sprang up to his right, and he sprayed it without stopping, hearing three rounds clang off plate steel. Ahead, the boarding ladder. He went up it three steps at a time, screaming through scorched lungs, pistol extended and hammer back. Inside, darkness. Shredded upholstery. Overhead luggage bins racked by bullets. A second man shape. He swung and triggered without thought. After two rounds, the striker clicked on an empty chamber, but he had anticipated that, and his free arm swept up. The lever popped free as it left his hand, and the grenade hit the cutout in the chest. Behind him he heard firing, thuds, muffled screams from the crew compartment. A whistle trilled faintly outside, and he paused, panting. It was over. He retrieved the dummy grenade and watched his men as they filed down the boarding ladder. Dark-haired, sweating, they clutched to their gleaming new weapons, pantomimed deadly jabs with their hands at each other. Some grinned, some looked bored. One, a new recruit not used to exertion in the heat, was vomiting over the handrail as he descended. Another had cut his forehead and dabbed at blood with the corner of his keffiyeh, which had come partly unwound. As Harissa lit a cigarette, he searched their eyes, their gestures, evaluating them against men he had known and fought beside in years past. Four had been tested already, on a border raid 4 months before. The rest were unblooded, but they had spirit. They had responded well to the physical and political training, accepting the trade, his harsh discipline, in place of the apathy and squalor of the camps of the Transjordan. They'll do, he thought. Not all of them. As with any group, a few would be flawed, cowards, or too foolhardy. But only a mission would find them out. All in all, he was content. He took a deep drag and silhouetted himself in the open door.
Escort!
They stared back at him, turning to hear, gripping their weapons. 30 seconds from 100 meters distance, he shouted, looking down into light-filled desert, into their upturned faces. The language he used was neither classical nor dialect. It was the new medial speech of the radio station, the newspaper. They were from many lands. It was their common tongue now.
So, do you know why you are doing this?
They stared at him, heads lifted, eyes alight.
I will tell you. Should you be assigned to seize a plane in flight, be aware. They have trained teams to take them back on the ground. They are as skilled and as well armed as you. Yet if you know how they will attack, you can defend. Or better yet, prevent them from attacking by using your hostages. Very well. Return to your places. We'll do it again, up the rear ramp this time.
As they filed away, the tall man glanced across the terrain, past the barracks huts, the wire. From here, from the top of the ramp, he could see far across the desert, see to the mountains that danced above the hot plain. Beyond them, and beyond a plain and another range of mountains, lay his land, his people's land, taken now by others. These others owned many things, jet fighters, missiles, tanks. Some said the atom bomb. There were not many of them, yet they were rich. They had power. But there were ways yet to fight them. Harissa took a last drag and flicked the cigarette to the desert floor. He raised his weapon above his head and looked down on his men. Staring at the mountains, he opened his throat to the sky.
Sharaf!
Majd!
Khulud!
Sweaty, exhausted, their teeth gleamed whitely as his men looked back and up to where he stood. Their hoarse shouts, their upthrust fists echoed his.
Sharaf!
Majd! Khulud! Honor, glory, immortality. Their enemies did not have the ultimate weapon. He did. His enemies were not ready to die. Part 2. The Liberty. Chapter 2. Taormina, Sicily. Lenson woke early that first morning ashore, roused by a golden triangle of sunlight. He watched it for a long time, not moving after he opened his eyes. The ray crept across the crumpled sheet toward him, so slowly it seemed not to move at all. It was quiet in the room. There was only the sound of two people breathing and the cry of gulls. When the sun reached his eyes, he blinked and raised his head. Turning in the bed, he looked at the woman beside him. His expression of wonder grew. She slept peacefully, lips parted, a strand of dark hair across her cheek. His eyes traced her face in the ruthless morning light. The lacing of veins at her nose, the curve of her neck, a slight tired crinkle of skin at the corners of her closed eyes. The fine features, the delicate complexion of Asian blood. Raising himself gently from the rumpled bed, he stood naked by it for a long time, looking down at her. She had wrapped the upper sheet around herself, and in the quiet light her face was like a sleeping child's. At last he turned, catching his breath as his bare feet left carpeting for tile, and crossed to the windows that opened on the balcony. He leaned out, feeling the stone morning cool against his bare arms. Rubbing at the scarred flesh of his shoulder, he stared out over the crystal blue of the Mediterranean. The Hotel Vecchio frowned down from the heights of Taormina like a captain from the bridge of his ship. It was a traditional hotel, a dignified hotel. Its walls were solid stone, and the curule chairs at each landing looked as if they had carried Caesars on holiday here by the Blue Ionian. She had chosen it days before, when the wives had arrived to await the ships. He thought it was too expensive, even in declining lira, but he had to admit she had chosen well. Its outdated calm would mirror the perfection of the coming days, the halfway point of the deployment. Here with her, he could forget for a time the fatigue, the monotony, the loneliness of 3 months at sea. Could push away, ignore the thought of 3 more months without her. For 4 days, he would be happy. He glanced back into the room. She was still, one arm outflung in the rising tide of golden light. He did not want to wake her. Their night had been passionate. Instead, he leaned out again, absorbing himself in the play of light on rock and sea, the gradual repossession of the world by the sun. Sicily was awakening. Gulls cried in sleepy hunger from the paling sky, and waves lapped against the cliff below the hotel. A squad of small boys, naked as puppies, clambered from rock to rock. One dived into the blue, coming up to swirl water from his hair. Beyond them, miles out, the sun was turning a flat and perfect sea to liquid bronze. He lifted his face to the light. It took so much work to deserve this sense of peace, and it came so seldom. Life was filled with 1,000 negatives. Boredom, anger, sometimes terror. But happiness was part of it too, if you did what you had to do. If you did that, only what was right, and did it with all your strength, then the good could come. Surely nothing truly evil, nothing irredeemably ugly could exist in a world with this capacity for beauty. A fishing boat, chugging slowly out to its day's work, drew its silhouetted bow through molten copper, shattering it into 1,000,000 glittering diamonds. Shattering it. Before his gaze, silently and tremendously, the bow, the cutting edge, grew to fill the sea, blot out the sky. A steel cliff. At its foot, a light of white gleamed cruelly, like bared teeth. The bow of an aircraft carrier, towering sudden and tremendous in the night. No, he thought. Not here. Sweat pricked his bare arms. He swallowed, fighting memory, hallucination, nightmare. It was morning. Italy. Susan. He could not avert it. His fingers cramped suddenly on ancient stone, transformed in his seething mind into the steel splinter shield of a destroyer. The Reynolds Ryan had been in company with a carrier task group. Late at night, several hundred miles west of Ireland, Dan Lenson had been on her bridge, junior officer of the deck. Someone had made a mistake. He stood frozen on the balcony for long minutes, looking out with unseeing eyes. The first wind of morning stirred the hair on his bare chest. The recording, like a tape in his head, ended at last. The North Atlantic, the cries of burning men receded, thinned, vanishing like a dream. The trawler was turning away. Men moved tranquilly about its distant deck, laying out their nets. Against his will, he looked toward the harbor. The curve of the town blocked his view, and that too was fine as the morning. He swallowed again. He did not really want to see the Guam. Behind him later, he heard the bed creak. When he turned from the sea, she was sitting up watching him, her eyes intent and unsmiling. Just seeing her stirred him after the months of longing. It was not her hair, dark as oiled walnut, swept back with one hand to lie across the pillow that stirred him, nor the revelation of nudity as she pulled back the coverlet to invite him in. It was not her bare legs, tanned dusky to the thighs, nor the small breasts, pale with a hint of saffron. It was true that, compared to her, other women seemed to him oversized, hairy, and common. He had never said that aloud to anyone, but he had remarked to Flasher one night on watch that he had never looked at another woman with interest since he had met her, a remark that read for once let pass in the darkness without a guffaw. "Morning, babe," he said, and smiled.
"How long have you been out there, Dan?"
"Not long."
"Isn't it peaceful here? I love to get up early and just stand there, like you, and look out. Are the boys swimming?"
"Yes," he said.
He ached to go to her, but he stayed by the window.
The wind was cool on his back.
It was good just to look at her
and let the hunger for her wait, wet itself into pain. It would be all the better to join her, feeling like that.
"I know one of them, Herculaneo. He waits tables at dinner. I'll introduce you."
"No, don't get up yet," he said, giving in. As he slid in beside her, they came together thigh to thigh, breast to breast. She was sleeping warm and smelled of the night's love, and her shoulders were small and smooth in his hands.
"Are you happy?"
she said into his shoulder.
"To be with you, yes." "And to be in Italy?"
"Yes, it's lovely."
"I think so, too. I'm glad you made us come."
"I didn't make you come, babe."
"That's true. I wanted to," she whispered quickly. She glanced around the room, then smiled. "I was looking for Nancy. I forgot where she was for a minute."
"It was good of Mrs. Hogan to take her. That was above and beyond the call of duty."
"Alicia's all right, and Nan likes her."
"How is she traveling? Hard to handle?"
"No, she's good most of the time, for her age." Susan laughed a little, raising her eyebrows.
"It's good for both of you. I think you were right to come out. You can make up your classwork. You can't always come to the med."
"I have to keep studying while I'm here."
"I know," he said, feeling her go away from him somehow, although she did not move at all. He felt he had phrased his remark wrong about her work and tried to retrieve it.
"You can study here and between ports.
You have your books. I don't want you to fall behind."
"Yes."
She snuggled close again, and he rubbed her shoulders and back, wondering, as he always did in the all too short times they were together, about how delicate and fine and at the same time strong and proud her body was, how close to him and silently wonderful. It seemed so seldom he was away so much, and yet when she was there, it was all-encompassing. It made him happy, and from it, somehow they had produced a child. He did not understand at all what he had done to be so lucky. She muttered something then. Her head was on his chest and he could not hear it.
What? He said.
I said I don't like being away from you, Dan.
I know.
I get afraid.
I know.
I said, when you hold me like this, it feels like nothing bad can happen to us, not ever.
He moved to hold her more tightly, feeling salt sting his closed eyelids. A wave of tenderness made him tremble as he caressed her back, from shoulder down the soft curve of thigh. He felt like telling her how much he loved her, but he did not say the words. Instead, his hand hesitated, then moved again, downward. She stirred.
What are you doing?
Nothing.
You don't want to make love, do you?
Who?
Me? You feel like it down here.
Well, we already did.
But that was last night.
Oh, yeah.
This is another day, isn't it?
Wait a sec, she said a few minutes later.
Let me up. I'll be right back.
But when she came back, she had to smile. She was ready for him, but he was asleep. Sitting beside him, she touched his face lightly, feeling the rough stubble of beard, tracing his mustache, seeing how tired he looked in the growing light. And then the annoyance came, unasked for, unwelcome. This was good being together, but it came too seldom. For the last 100 days, she had counted them, one by one, she had been alone. Yes, she loved him, but that wasn't what she'd expected from marriage. She frowned in the light-filled room and tried to push the thought away. She did not want to spoil Taormina. Susan Lenson turned angrily in her bed and reached for a book. They'd met at the academy, at one of the mixers that introduced the midshipmen to suitable girls. She had seen the notice on the bulletin board at the student center and thought the trip might be fun. Some of the other girls had been there, and although they thought the mids handsome, they said it was dull. Nowhere to go but the campus, nothing to drink, and they felt like toking would be a federal crime. Certainly not in front of all the straight-arrow midshipmen. But they also said Annapolis was a pretty place, especially in spring, and so she had thought to see what there was to see and then go back to the bus and study. But it turned out to be a military operation. Before the bus could start, they had to check names against the sign-up list. Then there was a kind of inspection. One girl had to leave. She was wearing shorts. Susan almost got off right there, and would have, except for Moira Lieberman, her roommate. The ox was eager to go, and when Moira wanted something, no one could turn her off. So she stayed too. When they arrived, a man in uniform, she had no idea what he was, escorted them straight from the bus to the dance. There had been no chance to duck out, so she and Moira had stood in the big hall and waited, smoking. When the mids came in, she saw immediately that they were all alike. The same hair, the same uniform, the same face.
They're robots, she whispered to Moira, who laughed.
Men of steel, her roommate said out loud. I hope. She stood in the middle of the room and smoked as they circled in.
She hated mixers.
You stood and hoped and waited and then drew some goob with bad breath. Her friends fell one by one to the robots, and she kept smoking, nervous now at the thought of not being asked to dance at all. She would have left, but the place was so big, she had no idea how to get back to the bus.
Excuse me, said someone behind her. You're here from Trinity?
No, Georgetown.
That's in D.C., right?
Hi, my name's Dan. Mine's Susan. Susan Chan. Some of the girls call me Bets.
Hello, Susan.
Want to dance?
I guess so. He was a robot. Tall, as good-looking as most of them, but he scared her a little. They were so different from the boys who came around in jeans and beards to drink beer with them on the steps in front of the library. This man wore a black uniform with gold on the sleeves. His hair was incredibly short. He danced as if unused to it, but after the second he seemed less threatening, or threatened. Later she was willing to go down to the steerage, that was the name of the snack bar, and sit waiting for him while he bought, honest, 2 milkshakes.
"So what do you do here?" she asked him when he came back, holding the milkshakes carefully away from his suit.
"Student, same as you."
"Come on, aren't you in the army?"
He winced.
"Navy."
"Yes, or sort of. I will be in a year."
She poked his sleeve. "What do these stripes mean?"
"I'm a segundo, a junior." He grinned as he said it, at her, and she didn't like his tone.
She decided that he was a prick. They all were. This was a fascist citadel, and it was stupid for her to have come here when she could have been studying.
"And what do you do?"
"I'm in archaeology."
"A junior?"
"Sophomore."
"Oh, so have you dug up any fossils yet?"
"Archaeologists don't dig up fossils. That's a paleontologist," she stated, and started to get up.
"I think I'd better..." "No, wait. Don't go. I'm sorry," he said. And she saw suddenly that he was uneasy too. Shy of her in a different way than she of him, but still shy.
"I don't know the difference. What is it?"
She hesitated, half to her feet, and then sat down again. She explained, and he asked questions. He didn't know much about the social sciences, but he was smart. She was warming to him, until she took out her pack and offered him one.
"No," he said, raising his eyebrows.
"You don't actually inhale those things, do you?"
"Jesus, you make it sound like a moral judgment."
"It's not good for you."
"It's none of your damn business, frankly."
"I know, Susan. You asked me."
"I didn't ask you anything."
"Okay," he said, looking puzzled and little boyish. And again, the change was so strange, so sudden, that she found it funny. He looked so serious and regretful. He was a character. She decided that he was cute. It was all she thought lying there beside him. Very strange how rapidly, how easily everything had happened after that. A year later, she had accepted his miniature, a little academy ring she never had had the courage to wear at school. When she graduated, they lived together for 6 months. Except for one nasty scene with Mr. Lenson. His father hated anyone, Dan said, who didn't look just like him, which meant white. It was all right, and one day they were married. Almost offhand, as if she had accepted it without thinking. Then Nan. She had not been planned. Nothing was 100% effective, but they had never discussed not having her. And so Susan Chan, who was once going to be the Margaret Mead of archaeology, was in Italy at last, but not for field work. Instead, she was a Navy wife, a mother, following the gray ships from port to port.
"Come on," she said, shaking him. "It's 8 o'clock, Sleepy. I want some breakfast."
He came awake like a tiger, and she gasped once and then reached to guide him as his long body moved over her. And the miles were no more. The long parting was forgotten, almost, and they were together. After breakfast, they walked together through the hilly town. He wore civilian slacks, a jacket, a short-sleeved shirt. Susan left her traveling jeans and pack for a navy skirt and tweed coat. The tables were already set out in front of street cafes. Trellised roses arched above the tables. the heating sky arched above all. She matched her stride to his long legs, glancing up at him. It was always like this, she thought, when they met again. Joy, but with a sense of strain. As if they had grown out of step during the months apart and needed to rematch their pace. It takes a while, she thought, to feel close to someone again. And then, as usual, it would be time for him to leave. So how was the trip, he asked her. Did you mind traveling with Mrs. Hogan? Susan made a face. Alicia's okay, but I can't take that bunch long. All through France, don't do this, don't drink that. I got sick in this hotel once. Why don't you wear something more ladylike? Oh, I'm sure they're real people, Dan. But I had to get away. I left them at Nice. You came here from the Riviera alone? It wasn't hard. Nan was good. We met a lot of people on the train. She told him an amusing story of going through customs at the Franco-Italian border between Menton and Ventimiglia, of Italian paratroopers in the second-class car smuggling wine under the skirts of fat peasant women. And then I stopped in Genoa and saw the city and spent most of the next week in Rome. That was tremendous. The Museo Vaticano, the digs in the subway. I went down to see Dr. Bicardi's team at work. Then Alicia and the others came through, and I came down here with them.
Where are they staying? Here?
No. They're down in Giardini, closer to the fleet landing. She laughed. But I came up here on the bus. I couldn't resist it. The view. And it gets you away from the ship, doesn't it?
It sure does. He grinned down at her. You know what I need, all right. So you've had a week to see the town?
I haven't seen squat. We stayed in our room, and I read François Bord, and Nan watched The Three Stooges in Italian, and we waited for you.
He reached out to her in the middle of the street and looked down into her dark eyes, laughing slightly hard for everyone but him. She was so vibrant, so alive, that she made him feel stiff and dull. But in spite of that, he loved her more intensely than he had ever thought he could love a human being. Give me a kiss.
I thought you Navy types didn't like affection in public.
Pretend I'm a civilian. Just for today, all right? He joked. She put her face up then, but her remark had spoiled something, and he lagged behind as she roamed through the high town. In the afternoon, they became suddenly purposeful and went sightseeing. Susan dragged him around San Pancrazio, telling him the walls dated from the 3rd century BC, the Greek theater, the Naumachia, which reminded him of a model towing tank. He trailed along with his jacket slung over his shoulder, sweat soaking his shirt, and took pictures. He wanted to put together, at the end of this cruise, an album of all the ports Comfibron 6 had visited, along with a few paragraphs of description in his own and Susan's hands. He imagined that someday, when they were old, they would look through it together. At 4, the sun grew too much for them, and they went back to the hotel and took a shower together, and made love again, and then napped. When they woke, they had a short but surprisingly bitter argument over where to go for dinner. He wanted to try the hotel dining room. She was sick of it and wanted to go out. In the end, they compromised. Dinner at the hotel, and the night out in Giardini, at the base of the hill. They found a noisy knot of the bachelor officers at the Hotel Naxos bar. He ordered gin and tonics. That was the only drink Susan really liked. The bachelors welcomed them, but Dan felt the conversation become awkward. Once you were married in the service, you moved out of their circle and into that of the married officers. After one drink, he nudged her, and they went out into the night again. They found a bench at the seawall, overlooking the water. It was cool, welcome after the heat of the day,
and the wind came in sweet and heavy off the sea, smelling of salt and faraway storm.
You didn't like them?
They were all right. Just, I'd rather be with you.
You're sweet, she said, looking away toward the sea,
and his eyes followed hers, out into the dark.
Dark, but blazing and twinkling with lights.
The evening was clear. Across the Strait of Messina, only 20 miles wide here at the meeting of Italy and Sicily, Reggio and Pellaro and Porto Salvo glowed like heaps of fallen fireflies. He made out 4 ships, moving slowly against the fixed lamps of the far shore, a green sidelight, red, 2 bound south, 2 north.
The traffic would get even thicker as they neared the neck of the strait, a few miles north.
He remembered taking the squadron through there a few weeks before. It had been a hairy evolution. Closer in, swinging a mile or so out beyond the breakwater, Guam had dressed ship. The electricians had been climbing about when he left the night before, and now the ship was a pyramid of lights. They stretched white from bow to truck, truck to stern, and multicolored lamps glittered along the edge of the helo deck. It was beautiful to see. A twinkling palace suspended in the darkness, beautiful to see.
What's the matter? She whispered, leaning on his arm.
Nothing.
Yes, there is. You're quiet. When you get quiet, come on, talk to me. Is it the Ryan? Is that still bothering you?
No. I mean, yeah, it still bothers me, yes, but that's not all of it.
Is it this ship? Is it old crazy Ike?
Yeah, he said, his voice so soft she could hardly hear it above the sigh of wind.
He's giving you a rough time?
Not me so much. I think he likes me. Red was his fair-haired boy on the way across. But now...
Red? Which one is he?
The chubby guy? He was the one juggling apples at Stan's party.
Oh, him. Lieutenant Flasher, right? He's so silly. I liked him.
Anyway, all of a sudden, Sundstrom turned against him. I have no idea why, but since then I've moved up to favorite.
That can't be so bad. Isn't that what you wanted? Isn't that why you volunteered for sea duty again, after the court-martial?
You don't know what it's like. His voice hardened, and she felt afraid a little. He never spoke to her like that. It was another side of him, the Navy side.
What do you mean?
Forget it. I shouldn't have mentioned it.
Dan, don't clam up on me. Don't pull that Academy bullshit. It wasn't your fault. There's nothing to prove. The board said, I don't care what they said. I keep thinking, damn it, I knew the maneuver was risky. I was only an ensign, but if I'd spoken up, argued with the captain, it might not have happened. Dan, don't please. They cleared you and the man above you.
The board hung it on Captain Packer because he was dead and it was neater that way. But none of us on the bridge came off clean, Susan. With that letter of reprimand in my jacket, my career is shot unless I pull 4 O's from here on out.
Then why are you worried if he likes you?
It's nothing I can pin down. He just lets things get on his nerves. He worries, all alone there in his sea cabin. Then he gives these crazy orders. He ridicules the officers on the bridge in front of everybody. He treats the chief staff officer like a plebe. I've never served with a guy like this before. Commodore McEnroe would tear your ass off if you screwed up, but at least you knew where you stood. He wanted a tight squadron, good performance, and he knew what he was doing. I try to give Sundstrom the benefit of the doubt. He's only had the job 3-4 months, but he seems to be getting worse, not better. He fell silent, still looking out to sea, toward the ship that was swinging now into the wind. Don't worry. I can take him all right. But sometimes I wonder,
If something happens while we're here in the med, I hate to think what it'll be like with him in charge.
Don't say that. I don't want to hear about that. Nothing's going to happen, is it?
Not that I know of. But that's what we're here for, Susan.
I don't know what you're here for. I don't know what business the Navy has this far from America anyway.
They both sensed the argument coming, and neither of them wanted it.
They dropped the subject tacitly. She turned to look across the bay.
There's yours, the big one, she said. And that other one. Didn't you say there were 6 ships in the squadron? Where are the others?
You don't put the whole task force into the same place for liberty. Not in the med. The port authorities don't like it. Too many sailors at once. And it's not a good idea if we're attacked.
Where are the other ships?
Scattered around. Guam and Barnstable County here. Newport and Ault in Naples. Spiegel Grove and Coronado in Palermo. Charleston and Civitavecchia. We'll join up after the port visits for the next exercise.
I'd like to go to Greece. And maybe one of the islands. Look at some of the digs. Moira's on a project in Cyprus. She wrote me about it.
Our next port is Iskenderun, Turkey. I guess you could go through the islands on the way.
And Yugoslavia?
I don't think that would be a good idea.
Why? It's a communist country, Susan. So what? They allow tourists.
You say that like it doesn't matter.
That they're communists? Dan, don't be ridiculous. You act like we were at war with them or something.
I just don't think it would be a good idea.
Well, is Turkey any better?
That's a good question, he said, thinking of the last exercise. They don't seem to want to play on our team anymore, as Sundstrom would say. They can't even answer their radios right.
I don't see why they have to, she said. Here we are, in their ocean.
It's everybody's ocean, Susan.
She twisted to look up at him.
Dan, speaking of that, have you thought about what we talked about before you left?
What's that?
About your getting out of the Navy.
He didn't answer for a while. He was looking out at the bay. At last he said,
Some.
You promised me you'd think about it.
I know, and I am. I'm just not ready to talk about it yet.
And again they both stopped, unwilling to go farther, and looked out to sea in silence. After a time he put his arm around her, felt the coolness of her bare shoulders. You getting cold, babe?
A little.
Want to head back?
I ought to stop by and pick Nan up. She'll get worried if she has to go to bed again without me.
He saw her just for a moment, not as a wife or lover, but as a mother. He smiled. He had wondered when Nan was coming how she would adapt, but she had.
Okay, he said. Let's go back to the bar. Jack Byrne has a rental car. Maybe he'll give us a lift up the hill after we pick her up, and we can show them Taormina.
All right, she said,
hearing the meekness in her voice and wondering at it. Where did it come from when she was with him? All her friends said she was so independent, so sure of herself. But when she was with this tall man, her husband on and off, he was gone so long it seemed like that, it all changed. She changed, became someone different. She did not like it. She reacted with resentment, and then in surprise heard herself arguing, complaining. She made herself stop thinking about it. This was his liberty, and they would enjoy it. They went out of the wind, out of the uncertain reaching and drawing back that was always there when they were together, into the hotel to look for the others.
Chapter 3. Palermo, Sicily. You could smell southern Italy, Sergeant Silkworth had told the mortar squad, long before it came over the horizon.
He had described the flies, the heat, the sewage that fouled the soft crystalline air. And then, relishing the open-mouthed attention of the privates, he had described its pleasures. Sweating that morning at formation, Private First Class Willard Staunton Givens, U.S. Marine Corps, slid his eyes beyond the flight deck of the Spiegel Grove, past Corporal Cutford's broad back beyond the life nets, to where a line of palest blue trembled in the early light. He sniffed. Once again, the sergeant had been right.
"Ten hut!"
bawled the top, and the 200 Marines of Bravo Company came to instant and complete attention. They stared out over the starboard side, ranks swaying with the roll of the old landing ship as the officers strolled out. Givens watched the back of Cutford's neck darken. It happened whenever the assistant squad leader saw brass. He glanced sideways at Harner, but the Kentuckian was looking straight ahead, his narrow face as still and empty as a worked-out mine.
"Have them stand easy," he heard one of them say. "Bravo Company, at ease!"
With 200 other men, Givens went back to parade rest with the joint-cracking snap that every Marine carried from boot camp and never let decay. Above them, looking down from a crane, two sailors snickered, then went instantly silent as a score of eyes swung up to memorize their faces. The company executive officer, Will could never remember his name, stepped forward and raised his voice over the omnipresent whine of the ship's ventilators.
"Got a message from the colonel last night," the exec began. "A well done on the practice landing yesterday. The movement inshore was expeditious. Units hit the beach in good order with an aggressive spirit. Specific comments on Bravo Company. Generally good, but battalion staff heard too much undisciplined chatter on the portable radios. In battle, reports have to be short, military, and to the point. You'll hear more from your non-coms. But in general, a good exercise. Today I figure this is no news to you. We're slated for some well-deserved liberty. We'll be in Palermo for 4 days. For those who haven't seen the country on previous floats, you can have a good time here, but you can get really screwed up, too. The way to enjoy yourself ashore is to keep a few simple precautions in mind."
As he talked on, Givens stared at the back of Cutford's head. A rifle butt, he thought idly, would fit it so fine. Even the plastic Mattel toy shoulder piece of the M16 would fit so nice right behind the main gunner's chocolate dark ear. "These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him. A proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, and heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord among brethren." His eyes drifted down to the lance corporal's hands. At attention, they rested curled against the seams of his utilities as if asleep, black-haired, pale-palmed, the index finger of the left hand nicotine brown over brother brown. A good swing, and then the satisfying chunk as the rifle butt hit.
"This off-limits area extends from just beyond the railway station, the Estazione Ferry Via Ria. Under no conditions are military personnel permitted to cross into it. The shore patrol will point the limits of this area out to you, should this be necessary."
"Estazione Ferry Via Ria," Givens repeated in his mind. The exec sounded like a pansy. No, that wasn't right. For a moment he felt scared. Thinking about hitting another Marine, being disrespectful, even in his mind, to an officer? That wasn't him. His lips moved, calling for strength to resist the unrighteous. He was letting Cutford and Silky get to him. Make him like them, in their own different, yet like images of power. So what if the exec knew some Italian? Maybe he could learn some himself. It had been easy enough to pick up a couple of words in Spanish at Rota. Hernandez said he sounded like a real raza, whatever that was. No, he had to discipline his thoughts. The exec was all right, for an officer, for an officer. Maybe, he thought guiltily, I'd better start listening up. Palermo has been a center of historical events and military campaigns for centuries. In AD 835, the Saracens captured the town and held Sicily for 2 centuries, till Roger the Norman recaptured it. It was taken by Allied forces under General Patton in 1943, in the largest amphibious assault in history.
Jesus,
he heard Lebo mutter to his right, his round face outthrust so that Will could see him even with his eyes straight ahead.
Shut your fucking mouth, Dippy,
came Sergeant Silkworth's rasping murmur down the line.
Where do they learn all that?
Givens wondered. Was that college, too? Or did all the officers get briefed before they hit a port, read it out of some manual?
And remember, as in any Catholic country, women are respected.
Make no advances until you ascertain their status.
A lot of the men here carry knives, and they know how to use them.
That brings up one last point, politics. The Italian communists are active here. They'd love to embarrass the Marine Corps and through us, the United States. Don't be drawn into arguments. We don't want any international incidents, and we don't want any of our troops hurt either. Any questions? Top, take over and dismiss the men. As the formation broke, Givens let his knees sag for a moment. He looked around. The land was nearer, a hazy stroke of pastel across a blue-gray morning. The snickering sailors were gone from the crane. Cutford was talking to another brother. He looked dangerous, as he usually was after being subjected to an officer's lecturing. Will moved toward the rail to avoid hearing, to avoid being drawn in. His boots scuffed on the nod skid of the deck. The ship was turning, the wind shifting to the starboard side. And as he reached the nets, the land came suddenly into full view, much closer than he had thought. He dropped to sit, dangling his legs above the wake 60 feet below, and looked out. Low blue, the flattened hills were hazy and contrastless, curved in a sweep of sea and morning pure sky. Other Marines were looking on, saying little. One of them was Washman, clicking away with an instamatic. Givens stared out. He was a long way from Carolina. For a moment he wished he had never come.
Where are you planning on going, Will?
Huh? Hey, Washout. He looked behind him to make sure Cutford was out of earshot, then turned back to the squad rifleman.
I guess just ashore. You heard the story Silky been telling? Be fun to see the town, wouldn't it?
Shit, yeah. I never been here either. That off limits, that sounds like the place to go. Everything past the railway station. We could spend all fucking 4 days there.
We could go there for a little while, yeah, said Givens cautiously.
And all the other stuff, too? The castles and the volcano and the mummies?
Mummies?
Aren't you listening? Lieutenant said they buried him in a cave, dressed and standing up. Said they scared the piss out of him. Well, he didn't say piss, but it's going to be on that tour they set up.
Yeah, sure. The tour.
Givens paused, knowing that what he really wanted every waking moment and most achingly at night was forbidden.
Well, I guess it wouldn't hurt to go ashore, look around a little.
I know one of the squids,
said Washman, twisting his pimpled face nervously around the deck. He was afraid of Cutford, too.
One of the gunner's mates? We was talking about the mortars. He wanted a round of 81, and I told him, no way, Jose.
Butterbars counts them fuckers every time we open the ammo locker. But he said he'd been to Palermo lots of times. He's an old guy, 30. I bet he'd tell us the places to hit. So let's go find him, man, said Will, thrusting his thumbs under his web belt and scowling. It was easy to act tough around the washout. In your pack, man. They found the gunner's mate coming out of the mess decks with a mug of coffee. He didn't seem to recognize Washman, but when they asked about the town, he nodded. They followed him up to the after 3-inch mount and sat on a ready service locker. Washout borrowed his ball pen and got the essentials down on a torn-out page of his guidebook for Marines. The rest of the morning oozed by, slow as promotion, like all the time they spent on shipboard. He and Washman wandered up to the bridge and watched the coast draw clearer until a lookout chased them off. They wandered down to the first-class mess, attracted by the sound of a television, and were ordered to move along. They went by the ship's store, hoping for pogey bait, chocolate, or gum, but it was closed. So after that, there was nothing to do but go back to the berthing space. Two decks down into the hull, it was as hot and smelly as any cavern inhabited for months on end by 200 prehistoric men. They sat at the card table and watched Dippy and Hernandez in their endless game of spades. Harner was there, sitting beside the Chicano rifleman, chain-smoking Marlboros like he always did. He never touched the cards, never kibitzed, volunteered nothing. He was the tallest in the squad and never complained, even on forced marches. Cutford was there, but he seemed to be on safe for the moment. Lying in his bunk, eyes closed, earphones over his stocking cap, he was nodding to his stereo. Silkworth, Lebo muttered, was in a meeting with the top. A fly droned among the slowly tilting bunk frames, the drowsing men. A little after lunch, they heard the squids man up for sea detail. The squad played one more hand and then drifted off to their lockers. Givens pulled a set of fresh Charlies from the wrappers they had been stowed in since the States. Lebo dimpled his tie in the mirror by the hatch. Hernandez patted on cologne, and tropical flowers filled the compartment. Harner meditated in the head, his straight razor dangling in his hand, sucking silently at a bloody lip. Givens checked himself in the polished glass. His garrison cap set straight on short, wiry hair. The collar of his khaki shirt was straight with starch, his globe and anchors a dull and warlike black. He pinned his ribbons level with the deck, conscious of their paucity. Someday, he promised himself for the 100th time, there would be more, the whole chestful. He bared his teeth at his image and wrinkled his nose, wishing it were not quite so wide, wishing he did not look quite so young.
What the fuck you doin', Oreo?
Nothing, man. He moved aside as Cutford shouldered his way into the mirror. You going on libs, bro? Cutford said nothing. He stared into the mirror, then shifted his narrow eyes to Will's. He's so much darker than I am, Givens thought.
Jesus, you stink, said the corporal.
That's Hernandez.
Why don't you put some on, too?
I don't like the smell. It's too strong.
Hey, said Cutford.
Dap, brother.
Givens dapped him unwillingly. He felt clumsy doing the rhythm. He missed one, and Cutford sneered and turned back to the mirror, flipping out a comb. There were gray wires in his hair.
Oreo, you fucked up Ofe lover. You can't even pass power, right?
Cutford, nobody goes for that power stuff anymore.
That's what they been telling you. Where you think you're going?
Out on liberty, like everybody else.
Like everybody else.
Yeah, that's just your tune, Oreo.
You just want to be one of the boys.
He accented the last word.
And where you planning to go on this sweet liberty the big man give you?
I don't know. Just go shore, walk around a little.
Who with?
Nobody. Just us peas in the squad.
You referring to your swan friends, of course.
The whole squad's going, man.
Will sounded plaintive even to himself. He looked around, hoping someone else needed the mirror, but the compartment was emptying, men pushing by them, stepping carefully up the ladder to keep their starched OD trousers from bagging at the knees. He wanted nothing more than to get away from this man, but he was part of the squad. The offer, at least, was a necessity.
Why don't you come with us?
The corporal's face came closer. Givens dropped his eyes to his gold chain, the twisted carat trinket Cutford wore without explaining, even under his uniform, even in the showers, and the invitation died on his lips.
Private Givens. Will, baby.
The corporal's voice became soft.
Listen, you don't need to go out with those people. You don't need to suck up to them and buy them beer. You don't need to snake their dirty whores in some enlisted man's off-limits crap house, then cover your ass with that Jesus talk of yours. You're a black man, a black king, every place but in your head, man.
Get off my case, Cutford. We bunk with them and eat with them, and we're supposed to be ready to fight with them. You're the main gunner, man. Why can't you figure you gotta live with them, too?
Fuck you then, Oreo. Someday you're going to see the light. Till then.
He tensed, expecting violence, but the corporal disappeared from the mirror. He hadn't touched him, even. When he was sure he was gone, Will breathed out. He removed his cap, ran his comb through the stubble again, and ran up the ladder to the main deck. From 60 feet up, he could see all of Sicily. From the pier back, the city lay like a pastel carpet. Miles of buildings festered between the hills and spread beyond them. Far inland, a massive volcanic cone thrust upward like a thunderhead. In the afternoon brightness of the Mediterranean, Palermo seemed endless, immense, the largest city on the planet. And after weeks at sea, or on barren maneuver areas, the honking, dog-barking murmur of land, the chuffing of a rusty tugboat, the rich smells of exhaust and sewage and pasta were intoxicating. He joined 10 score other Marines and a few sailors at the rail and leaned his elbows on the warm metal, breathing deep. Silkworth was right, he thought again. He had smelled it from far at sea, had smelled it stronger and deeper all through the morning. Even the stink of the compartment, soap and ship, starch and cologne had become part of it, natural, like the perfume of a beautiful unwashed woman, a naked woman who spread her legs from hill to hill before him. To ease his sudden excitement, he leaned forward, looking down at the pier. Below them, on the outstretched stern gate, the ship had moored stern to. Sailors in dungarees shouted and jumped back. The gangway had broken loose. It tilted, balanced for an instant, and then slid gracefully into the brown murk at the foot of the pier. The Marines groaned. The sailors stared stupidly into the water. A fish circled belly up in sluggish scum, drink cans, oily rainbows. A fat chief in whites came out from inside the well deck and began giving orders. The Marines shouted suggestions. A couple of line handlers, a policeman, and a priest in hot-looking black watched from the pier. The sailors fished cautiously off the stern gate. The grapnel snagged something. They hauled away together, and the end of the gangway crept up into view, dripping slime.
"Don't rob it again,"
Will shouted down, and beside him, Washman laughed.
"These friggin' squids kill me," he said.
The priest caught a heaving line, and the policeman and 2 line handlers joined him on it. When the far end of the brow banged on the concrete, the chief ran across and began lashing it to a bollard.
Let's head on out,
said Hernandez, with a deep sigh of anticipation. On the pier, free at last, they ranged themselves in swaggering line abreast. Past two passenger liners, the quay ended at a modern-looking concrete building that, as they neared it, became flaking, pre-war. Its walls flapped with posters in fading greens and reds. He looked back once. The Spiegel Grove looked small, moored among the liners, small and old, graceless and dirty. It had carried him in her guts for 3 months, and every minute of it he had hated her. He did not look back again. The six of them, Givens, Washman, Hernandez, Sergeant Silkworth, Lebo, and Harner, stopped by common accord at the first bar beyond the gate, on a cobbled street as full of diesel fumes as traffic. The proprietor grumbled at their dollars, but took them. After two or three beers apiece to take the edge off, they headed uphill at a more leisurely pace. Silkworth declined to lead. He said he had been drunk every time he'd been here, and he could never remember the way. They strolled uptown, conspicuous in starched Charlies amid the thronging, swift-talking Sicilians. Givens stared open-mouthed at the shabby, crumbling buildings, the mobile junkyard cars, the hammer and sickle posters, six to every wall. He felt conscious of his uniform, his foreignness, his skin. He closed up on Lebo and Silky and Washman in the lead.
"Be careful of your watches," Harner said, startling them all.
"Left here," said Lebo, turning halfway around.
Washman pulled out his page, and they studied it on a corner, looking for an orientation point. Several boys offered to guide them. When the Marines ordered them away, they left, slapping their arms in a gesture Will thought picturesque. The smallest, a shaven-headed runt of five or six, tagged after them, making motions for a smoke. At last Harner gave in and tossed him a Marlboro.
Then he wanted a light. "Aren't you a wop, Dippy?"
"Fuck no, man. Lebo's a good Portuguese name."
"Think we turn left here, huh?
Why didn't we get some street names from the squid?
Let's ask this kid where the station is."
"Hey, man, where's the station? Railroad?"
"Comprey?" "He don't talk English, man."
"The railroad kid. Choo-choo."
"Ding-ding," said Lebo.
When the others laughed, he reddened.
"Hey, you fuckers, try to talk to him then."
"Estazione Ferroviri," said Will, on an impulse.
The boy brightened and pointed to the left. Harner gave him another cigarette. They turned left.
"Pretty slick there, Will," said the sergeant. "Where you picked that up?"
"The exec said that at formation this morning."
"He did? I didn't remember that. You must have a natural gift for languages, Private Givens."
"Oh, I just picked it up," said Will, pleased.
"Marlboro," said the boy.
Harner looked at Silkworth, who shrugged as if to say, "If we don't, some other guys will. He ain't our responsibility." He shook one more loose and held it out. The boy snatched the pack, his motion so quick he left Harner holding out his hand, and melted toward an alley.
"Eh, fuck you, Marines," he said.
"Jesus Christ," said Washman. "We grow up fast back here," said Dippy. "Maybe he's one of the sergeants," said Washman.
They laughed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.